trails and ghost towns with Mike Roberts and Bill Barlee.
Welcome to Gold Trails and Ghost Towns. I'm Mike Roberts with Bill Barlee, our resident guide, author, former educator. Well, you're still educating me about all sorts of things. Where are we going today, for example? I'm the student.
Mike, we're going into, I think, one of the most fascinating corners of southeastern British Columbia. And this is the Wildhorse. Even the name is kind of attractive.
Yeah?
Because it's an old area. It's been populated by the whites for 125 years, a little more. And it's kind of a forgotten corner.
You know, is it near anything we could recognize today?
Yeah, it's kind of northeast of Cranbrook and east of a place called Fort Steele.
So it's not readily known to us today. It must have dropped out of sight.
Out of the hundreds of thousands of people who have gone into Fort Steele, not one half of 1% have gone the extra 7 miles into the Wildhorse. This is what we're going to do today.
Okay. Take a break here. Be back in a second to examine the Wildhorse right after these words.
Still get butterflies.
Funny, she doesn't look married. I bet she cries or bites her lip.
Hello, stranger.
I'm hardly a stranger.
Well, you are late.
I know. You shouldn't have waited 10 years for this. Happy anniversary.
The Diamond Anniversary Band. Tell her you'd marry her all over again.
You sure can't pick an appetizer.
For over 50 years, A&P has been the people's choice. Why? We sell what people want. 4 out of 5 people prefer national brands. And that's what we feature. Of course, we also have our famous A&P store brands, like 8 O'Clock Coffee. All at prices that make us the smart choice. See our flyer and save on the brands you, the people, really want.
A&P, the people's choice.
Hey, how was our trip?
Good.
What's new?
Did you see our app?
Great, huh? What's this?
Our 800 number.
I thought we didn't have the budget.
Hey, if you want to play in the big leagues.
Yeah, but can we afford it?
We can now.
Bell's new 800 entry. Subscribe for less than $1 a day.
Hello. Oh, you've seen our ad.
We make it easier for potential customers to talk to you.
We're big enough to handle that.
Long distance business sense. Call us.
December 3rd, 1968. This was the performance of a lifetime. He was the king, and this was his crowning moment. Elvis, the 68 Comeback Special. Now, finally available on home video. This is Elvis at the peak of his power. Elvis at his most intimate. The 68 Comeback Special. 76 minutes of rare concert footage. 27 of the King's greatest hits. This is a home video classic. Order yours now for just $29.95, and you'll also receive this Elvis Collector's Edition art print to commemorate this historic event. This is an exclusive TV offer. To order yours, call 1-800-241-0700 or send $29.95 plus $4.95 shipping to Elvis TV Special Offer, Box 3350, Station D, Willowdale, Ontario.
Welcome back to Gold Trails and Ghost Towns. Mike Roberts with Bill Barlee, going to visit southeastern British Columbia today in an area you called Wildhorse.
Yeah, it was originally called Studhorse, Mike, and then they changed the name to more decorous Wildhorse. Studhorse Creek, then Wildhorse Creek. And you know, this, it came into being, and you can see this shot here. This is how the first miners probably would have seen it without the bridge, of course. Yeah. You're looking at Fisher Peak in the background. That's the Rockies. And you're heading up into an unknown creek. The year is 1863, and a party of American miners was coming by, and they saw a stud horse up there, decided to investigate this creek on their way up the Kootenai, and stopped up, found that the creek was spectacularly rich, which was unusual because ordinarily the creeks flowing west out of the Rockies or east out of the Rockies are not good for placer gold men. But this was the exception that proved the rule. And so these guys went up there, and they began discovering nuggets that were really quite... They were spectacular in size. Some of these nuggets were a pound. The largest nugget discovered on the creek was 3 pounds troy. And the result was that the American miners began flooding into the area from the south and making a quick hit on Wild Horse. And nobody knows exactly how much came out of Wild Horse. The figures range from several millions up to 50 million. And this was at $20.67 a pure ounce.
What else is happening right about now? Barkerville was at 58. Were these guys sort of en route there? And got
actually, Barkerville is about 61. Yeah. Rush started in the lower Fraser.
These guys were heading in that direction?
No, they weren't. They were just heading up into the northern British territories as they knew them. And they probably would have gone to Barkerville, but they didn't move out of Wild Horse.
Why? When estimates of up to 50 million...
Yeah.
In that area.
And, you know, the gold was coarse, it was close to the surface, it was in a distance of about 2.5 miles, most of the gold, then seemed to cut right off. So there was one major tributary, which was Boulder Creek, which was also extremely rich.
So here we are talking, 10 miles from where Cranbrook is today, 10 miles northeast?
Yeah, approximately 7 or 8 miles. You could go as far as 10.
Yeah.
And of course it was a wild, wild area. You're moving up in altitude there. You're getting back into the real wilds of the Rockies. And even today it has kind of that feeling, you know.
As I understand it, there became conflict almost right as soon as the white prospectors came in with the Indians of the area, the Kootenai Indians.
Yeah, what happened is there was an early murder of two miners, and the white miners in Wild Horse blamed it on the Indians. There was a shot of the Indians pretty close to the time. This is Chief Isidore and the Kootenai Indians, and they're a very proud group of Indians, and they said they didn't do it. And I believe the Indians. They did not do it. It was a bushwhacking, and I think it was done by other miners because there were a bunch of renegades in that area, a bunch of American miners who drifted in with these gold camps looking for easy pickings. But what the result was that the Northwest Mounted Police came into Fort Steele in 1884. That was much later than the original rush started, under the famous Sam Steele.
So he may not have had any real work to do, that the murder and stuff not being the trouble of the Kootenays, the Kootenai Indians caused, so... Maybe he didn't bring peace to the area. It was a figurehead.
Well, yes, that's true. He didn't have to. They didn't put a stick of a palisade up or a blockhouse or anything in there. They simply kept the law, and 4 years later they moved out.
And we got a number of artifacts that come from this era. This is one here, and we always have a sort of show and tell before we do the show to see who can come up with it. And the closest we got is this is a serving tray, and they didn't have anything lighter than cast iron to make out of it. What is this?
Well, actually, it is a type of serving tray, and it's really quite an unusual artifact. When the original miners came in, they couldn't carry a stove with them. But they weren't about to turn their meat on a spit all the time, so they thought, okay, this is the easiest way. They brought this in. This is kind of a portable stove. Put the meat here and sliced it, and when there was too much fat, they just dipped it off like that, and the meat still stayed there, and... It was an easy way to cook, and this was discovered in one of the famous placer gold areas.
Did you discover this, or did you buy it from some?
No,
this
I
would be a treasure.
I bought a whole collection off an old guy called August Sinclair Milliken, a very, very fine man. Passed away a couple of years ago, and I bought his collection many, many years ago.
August Sinclair Milliken.
Yes, commonly known as Gus Milliken.
Cuss?
Gus.
Gus. Gus Milliken. All right. That's neat. Do they still sell one of those down at your local hardware store? It's better than the aluminum thing that I use.
Yeah, I haven't seen them for years, Mike.
But a great idea. This obviously started the ball rolling. I mean, how many more people came as soon as the news of the riches got out?
They think about 1,000 miners streamed into the area, mostly from the south, but then the British government said, ooh, we have problems here. All this gold is flowing south, and the goods are coming up from the south, so we'll build a trail. And this shows the Dewdney Trail. And the Dewdney Trail started at Fort Hope, essentially, and then went, but the eastern terminus was the Wild Horse. So they were heading for the Wild Horse. They felt the Wild Horse would be another caribou. Now, that was a mistake, but they also hit other places along the way. They hit the Ponderay, they hit Rock Creek and Boundary Creek. So that all-red route, which was the Dewdney Trail, came hundreds and hundreds of miles over to the Wildhorse, approximately 500 miles.
The all-red route.
They called it the all-red route. This is the all-British route.
Oh, of course, the sun never sets, the thin red line.
That's right.
The all-red route.
Yep.
The characters, of course, that come into that area. You've got a story about an Irishman who came to
grief. Yeah, there were a lot of, as I say, we alluded to this before, that there were a lot of very desperados, really, in Wildhorse. And, you know, there were no lawmen there at the time. So the only lawmen in the whole area were the circuit judges put out by Matthew Bailey Begbie, who was erroneously called the hanging judge. And most of these circuit judges were Irishmen, like himself and other, you know, there were a lot of Northern Irishmen. And one of these Irishmen was a guy called Peter O'Reilly. And O'Reilly was an interesting guy because there was a shooting in Wildhorse, a guy called East Powder Bill.
East Powder Bill.
He came from the East Powder River in the United States.
See.
And that's why he was called East Powder Bill. And of course, nicknames were common at that time. Every second guy had a nickname. He shot a young Irish prospector and killed him. And a drumhead jury made up of American miners found this guy not guilty, and he just wandered back across the line, essentially scot-free. Well, the news of this drifted down to Begbie. No law in the Wildhorse, so he sent in Peter O'Reilly. And Peter O'Reilly was a pretty commanding individual. He came into camp, and he had a big meeting with the miners, a little bit of liquor flowing here and there, and he sat down with the miners. He said, "By the way, boys," he says, "if there's another shooting or another killing in Wildhorse," he says, "there's going to be a hanging in Wildhorse." And there was no more murder. There was a bit of gunplay, but no more murders in Wildhorse.
This little weapon here, this is a beautiful piece.
Yeah.
It comes from that area?
Evidently came out of that area, yeah.
This is, I don't know, this looks like a dandy's gun. It's nickel-plated, it's engraved, it's got pearl handles on it, and it still has an action. You could take this to the range today.
Yes, it probably would shoot, and that was found on an abandoned cabin, actually, and a number of things have been found in that area. Of course, this is an area that is still steeped in history, and there are half a dozen cabins or eight cabins standing in the immediate vicinity of the old town. You know, Mike.
Still to this day.
Oh, yes.
We'll see them a little bit later on.
Yeah.
So all of these people. But it didn't come to be, I guess, a built-up town. It was sort of a cabin town, wasn't it? There was no big buildings like
there
elsewhere.
Well, what happened is they went directly into the center part of the gold fields, and the center part of the gold fields, they built a little town called Fisherville, named after Fisher, one of the originals in the first party that came in. Fisher Peak is named after him, too.
Yeah.
So Fisherville was built, well, they felt well above the diggings, which was essentially down on Wildhorse Creek, now called Wildhorse River. But as time went on, they went over those diggings and they exhausted the gold there. Then they began looking around for gold elsewhere, and they found Fisherville itself was extremely rich ground. And just to the north of Fisherville were some huge banks of gravel that were ideal for hydraulicking. So here was Fisherville sitting actually in the center of the gold fields. And so the result was they started undermining Fisherville, and eventually when they started hydraulicking this area, they began to run right down through Fisherville. So Fisherville had to be removed, and so they actually dismantled the town piece by piece.
And we'll get to what they did with the town or where they started another town. But getting the ore out of here, some of the ways they got the ore out of here we've seen before when we talked about the caribou. But these big monitors, they really did the job.
Oh, sure they did. This was an atrocious method of mining, but it was the most efficient method of mining, and it was the cheapest method of mining. Water power did all the work. You shot your monitor, your stream of water stream from the monitor, it hit the gravel bank, broke the gravel down, the gravel came down with the water and flowed through a sluice box, which was on bedrock.
Yeah.
And then you went into the sluice box and cleaned out the gold, because the gold stayed behind because it's of a specific gravity. Mm-hmm. It was a very easy method, and of course the Chinese were quick to realize, and they became excellent monitor operators. They were hydraulic men of the first order.
Yeah. This next shot actually shows both a monitor in the background and a Chinese miner in the foreground. He's doing a little cleanup activity here?
Yeah, this may be Ki Chin, I'm not sure. There are a number of miners there, and you can see the monitor in the background. It's also called a giant. And that's probably a 6-inch or an 8-inch. That's a pretty big monitor. He is now cleaning up the gold from the cleanup.
Now, would he be doing this for the company, or would he be doing this for himself? Is he an independent, or who is the guy cleaning up here?
Very debatable. He may be independent by that time. Most of the original Chinese miners came over under the auspices of what they call the Chinese Six. So they were indentured, really. And they had to pay that back at exorbitant interest rates. And But eventually, they were able to operate as free miners. And they stayed on the ground as long as the gold was flowing. And their ultimate aim, of course, which we discussed in one other program, was to get back to China. And most of them did get back to China, one by one and singly, and sometimes in pairs. They left the gold fields of British Columbia, made the long trip back to China, and retired there and eventually died in China. And of course, they all felt that they didn't want to be buried in British Columbia, and this was the responsibility of their relatives in China, that if they did die in Gunshan, which was the, you know, the western or the Golden Mountains, mm-hmm. that their remains would be shipped back to China. And that's why you very seldom find any intact Chinese burials.
Where there was a Chinese cemetery, they're just depressions where the graves had been dug up and
that's
the bodies
right.
exhumed.
Yeah, you'll see that in the Caribou and the Similkameen and then the Kootenai and so on.
This is a really beautiful artifact. I mean, you would talk about treasure stories, but
What
is this made out of?
Well, this is made out of ordinary wood, but the actual beads on this abacus are made out of rosewood, which is extremely hard. So that they were, and he made them out of rosewood because he knew they'd last. And they're handled a lot. He could make the frame anytime he wanted. And this is the original computer or calculator. And, you know, in the hands of a Chinese, it works extremely well.
I've never actually seen one done, but did you find this, or is this...
This also came from the August Sinclair Millikan collection originally, and I bought it off him many, many years ago. He insisted at the time this is a very important piece, because there are very few handmade calculators or abacuses like this, and this was all done by hand. Each one was pieced together and shaved out, and it's really a beautiful artifact.
It is indeed. You've got a couple of other artifacts here, too. This is a lock, I guess, kind of a lock from... From where?
Well, it's actually from a Chinese chest that was found on the Wildhorse. A man named Cyril Murray and I, he's an old friend of mine. We used to go over there and excavate once in a while. And we found a number of things, parts of the gold scales and a lock and some Chinese musical instruments and some Chinese bottles and some pottery and some coins and all sorts of interesting stuff in there. And this is one of the items we found.
And one other, this one here. It's kind of worn in the middle. Is this worn from use or...
No, that's actually to put the ink there. That's almost an ink well. It's used for mixing up ink, which was a harder ink than we would use. And of course, everything the Chinese used, they had designs. This is a floral design here. And it has a nice feel. If you feel that artifact, it really has a nice feel. I've found a number of those up on the Wildhorse, too. Most of them broken.
Gee, that would be such a treasure, isn't it?
Yeah, it's beautiful stuff.
And the ink that they would use this for their calligraphy, for their
yes.
Chinese newspapers, their letters home?
Yes, not a newspaper in that area, but there would be a village scribe in almost every town. Usually the merchant would handle that for the Chinese miners who are sometimes illiterate.
We see some Chinese in this shot. What building is this?
Well, that's the post office, 1883, 20 years after the strike has been made. They're still here. And, you know, the surprising thing about that, Mike, is everything else is gone, but the rocks are still there. You can wander down that old street and still see the rocks on the left-hand side.
And there's a character in that shot as well, who you mentioned earlier, this Griffiths fella.
Yeah, this is Dave Griffiths, and he was probably the guy who stayed with Wildhorse longer than any other miner, with exception of possibly some of the Chinese, stayed there about 50 years. And he, even after the turn of the century, Dave Griffiths was still taking out on a good year between 400 and 500 ounces by himself.
400 and 500 ounces.
That's a lot.
That's right. The town, a bit of a log cabin town, but bigger certainly than Fisherville was, I'd take it. Tell us about this shot. This shot really enthuses you. You love this shot.
Yeah, because I've walked down that. The road is exactly the same as it used to be. It still cuts where it cut in 1883, over 100 years ago.
Yeah.
And you can see the rocks on the left-hand side where the post office stood. And you can see the depressions in the ground on the right-hand side. And this photograph, if you look at it very closely, you'll see the cabins in the foreground, but look carefully on the right-hand side, and you'll see buildings away down the street. This was a town of about half a mile long, cabins on both sides of the street.
And how many people, you say, 1,000 people
well,
in here?
Well, probably not by 1883. That number, because the easy diggings were gone, probably drifted down to about 400 or 500. But still a significant town.
And again, what I remark on is I think of all the towns we've talked about before that have the clapboard houses and sort of big sort of official European-style structures. These are all log cabins and sort of rustic and no big company in here yet.
Not yet, although the big companies start coming in soon after this. They realize the shallow diggings are gone. You have to go deeper. You have to supply water. It becomes not poor man's diggings anymore. And here's one of the examples. This is the Dardanelles mine. Now, this is a lode mine or a hard rock mine, Mike. up at the towards the headwaters of Wildhorse Creek, mm-hmm. and they have a big arrastra, and you can see the arrastra inside. Yeah, that's what's fed by the wheel. It turns the arrastra itself, and the arrastra is a Spanish word meaning raster, or which means actually a grinding sort of thing, and it grinds down the ore, and they get out the hard rock. So they felt that the hard rock gold, they were looking for the source of the gold in Wildhorse Creek. Yeah.
But I don't hear the name Fritz Augustus Hines or any of this kind of some of the people we met before. This is still small companies.
Yeah, these are still guys, you know, groups of individuals forming small companies, both placer and hard rock.
Now, we got a shot here of, it looks like a slit trench. What, is this another hard rock operation?
Well, yes, it was. This is about a gamble company. Probably taken about 1917 or 1918, because they were in there then for about 3 years. And they decided to explore or prospect some of these canyons coming into the Wildhorse. They didn't do too well. They all got gold. But, you know, it's a very uncertain sort of process. You can do extremely well, or you can do extremely poorly. And, of course, they were operating on somebody else's money, so that made it not too difficult for them.
So this whole thing starts in 1863, and it continues through to 1917. It continues a long time.
Yeah, it's over 50 years, even by then. And it goes on right to about the 1920s, Mike. Then it starts to dwindle. The last of the Chinese miners are gone by the 1920s. And so that Wildhorse kind of becomes the typical placer town. It stands there in repose. There's no echo of mining in the immediate vicinity, and the cabins start to fall down, and it's decaying, and it's typical of all these towns in the West.
There's still some of Kootenay there, and when we come back after this break, we'll take a look at some of the buildings which have remained into the more modern period, and there's gold in Emnar Hills still. We'll do that right after this break.
At 8 p.m., Coanna Bossart bought an Ontario Instant Millions ticket. At 8:05, she was a millionaire. Now, Ontario Instant Millions is back with the new Diamond Edition. 1 in 3 odds to win cash plus multiple million-dollar prizes. Think she'll play? Remember when you waited until after lunch to pick up your Ontario Instant Millions ticket? Well, now we're launching the new Diamond Edition. 1 in 3 odds to win cash plus multiple million-dollar prizes. One scratch could change your life and how long you take for lunch.
This summer, live at the CNE, Labatt Blue presents in concert Tom Cochran. August 31st. Plus special guests on the CNE Grandstand. 5440 and Sue Medley. One night, August 31st. Get your tickets now at Ticketmaster. Charged at 870-8000. Your ticket price includes admission to the CNE Crown, a CPI CNE production association with Coca-Cola Classic, the official soft drink of music.
Only the Glad brand of zipper bags show you they're sealed. Glad zipper bags, because the Glad Lock seal changes color. Green means freshness is sealed in. What's so special about Glad lunch bags?
Glad. They're water resistant. Glad. They're easy to tie and light and easy to carry. Glad. And they're reusable too.
Look for Glad lunch bags.
Red Lobster may have gone too far this time. A full pound of tempting shrimp overflowing your plate. Red Lobster's never offered you, whoops, so much on one plate. 10 grilled, 15 butterflied, 11 garlic broiled. A full pound of our most popular shrimp. For a limited time, so much shrimp with all the extras, you might need a doggy bag.
Red Lobster for the seafood lover.
Introducing Farber Peel, the exciting new electric peeler from Farberware. Farber Peel peels carrots, peels potatoes, peels cucumbers in a fraction of the time. It sheds onion skin before you can shed a tear. Farber Peel is so strong it can strip the tough ends off broccoli. Yet it's so gentle and safe it can peel a tomato for stewing or canning. But Farber Peel does a lot more than just peel, without slicing your fingers. Make shaved chocolate for your favorite recipes. Great cheese for omelets and pasta. and get perfect julienne slices for salads and stir fry. To clean, just run it in a glass of water or slip out the blade and pop it in the dishwasher.
Treat yourself to this remarkable electric peeler through this exclusive television offer. Farber Peel is so convenient, you'll use it every day. Order yours now. Call 1-800-248-6400 or send $34.95 plus $4.95 shipping to Farber Peel TV Special Offer, Box 3350, Station D, Willowdale, Ontario.
This would be the gem in any bottle collector's collection. This is a beauty. Green, blown bottle, I guess?
Blown bottle.
And what's the thing around the neck?
Well, you know, they had decorations on the bottle. This is kind of unusual, and this is probably a serpent around here in the throat of the bottle. And this is quite a valuable bottle, and typical of the bottles in the gold fields, Mike, and there were literally thousands of very fine bottles and pieces of pottery out of the Wildhorse, because people were there for so long. So many miners were there for so many decades.
There was a lot of garbage dumps, which is your treasure chest.
Yep.
There's still some buildings and left and some ruins of the area.
This picture I took, this photograph, about 20 years ago, and the cabin is still standing, that cabin in the background, and the remains of the Victoria Ditch, which are down by the river itself, that's the Wildhorse, and a plaster post, you know.
That's that sort of stump at the front of the screen.
Yeah, it's probably gone. Probably somebody's taken that, unfortunately.
That would have identified the corner of a claim or something?
That's right. Would have identified either the initial post or the final post. And there's another cabin standing in this region. And there are about six or eight cabins in pretty good state of repair in the whole area.
And a rock work in front. They took pride in the place that they were living?
Yeah, well, of course, they were cleaning out the gold, too. That's why it was piled up there.
You find bottles and you find coins. You're a great coin finder. These all come from this general area?
Yes, they all come from the Wildhorse, actually from Fisherville itself. And there are a number of coins there, 1880s American stuff, 1880s Canadian, Chinese coins and Chinese little gambling counters. And it's an interesting area for those interested in the treasure of the Old West.
Where do two scuba divers get into this game?
Well, you know, in late 70s, two scuba divers, one from Alberta, one from Fernie, came in, a teacher from Fernie, actually, just talking to him a little while ago. And they were talking to an old miner down in Cranbrook. And this old miner said, you know, boys, if I were going underwater, I'd look at this spot. Because I remember when I was a kid, a guy walked across the Wildhorse, and it was fairly close to Fisherville. And that river's a tough river to ford. And he got caught in high water, and he was carrying a bucket of concentrates, which is gold mixed with black sand. And he lost the bucket, lost his gun, lost some coins, went underwater, managed to save himself. So on this story, they decided to go in there, and they went in there and actually started dredging in that section, came up with 28 ounces of gold in one spot. The gold hadn't moved a foot. And they found an old 1850-odd half dollar, U.S. half dollar, silver half dollar, and some of the bullets. They didn't find the gun, but they found the gold, they found one of the coins, and they found some of the lead bullets.
And you say that this is still harbors. You're aware of a location where there might be some coins. There's also a creek you call Boulder, which harbors some gold. This area is still potentially exciting.
Well, not only that, Mike. The whole area is shrouded in this feel from the past. You can go into the Wildhorse, and you can go up there, and you cut down into that road because you go right past the original Wildhorse Cemetery, which is still there, kept in good repair. And then you cut down through the center of the old town. If you look carefully, you can see where everything was, and you can see the town was laid out. And that's, we're talking now about Wildhorse or Kootenay. And the town was laid out on either side of that road. And then you go down to the river and see the remains of the old Victoria Ditch. And then you wander through the area, and you'll see big crevices where the Chinese miners cleaned out these crevices sometimes 30 feet. And the crevice narrows right down to the bottom, and they hardly missed a grain. Excellent miners.
You know, you think of this kind of country, and when I go anywhere with you, for example, I see the forest, but when you point the stuff out in between the trees, you see back there is a little line that's a foundation line. That's the way you have to go. You can't sort of stand back and gaze at the whole place. You have to get into it.
Yeah, and you have to go from the information you have. You know, when you go into this area, you have to know that this is where the town was. Most of the town was on the right-hand side of the road, and this is where most of the mining activity was. And so where's the most plausible place to look if you're actually looking for this?
Is it the kind of place which could have another gold boom? Is Boulder Creek the kind of place that, you know, could see another Headley start up or something like that?
I doubt it, but some of those canyons leading into the Wildhorse may indeed contain gold.
And maybe some coins and maybe a bottle or two.
Oh,
fascinating stuff. Started off as Fisherville. They mined it. Sounds a bit like the Phoenix story.
Yeah.
And then built another town called Kootenay, started in 1863 and really ended in the 20s, had a tremendous history, and that's been our story from Gold Trails today. We'll be back next week. Join us then.